A food forest is a system where we emulate nature to produce food. And the way we do this is to use all the layers in a classical natural forest, but we replace the species in those layers with more productive species. So food forests are considered to have 7 layers or even 9 or even more. We talk about the tall trees. We talk about smaller trees like prunes or apples. We talk about bushes and we talk about herbs. And there is also aquatic layer and fungal layer. So there's different layers of the food forest that collaborate together as they would in a natural ecosystem. But instead of using fully natural plants, we use entered varieties of species that are very edible for humans, or we introduce species that are not native to the exact location, but are more productive in terms of food, so that we can combine the functions of a natural ecosystem with the functions of agriculture to produce food for also humans. So in an orchard, you will rarely see the production of mushrooms. You will often see monocultures of one species. The herbaceous layer is not used at all in typical orchards. So it's all about apples or all about pears or all about plums. And what we do in a food forest is we introduce herbs and climbing plants into the orchard. So it will look messy, but it will also be more productive than a typical orchard. What we see in a typical business, and especially in a typical agricultural business, is that it's driven by profit. And the profit consists of, gains versus cost, right? And so we try to bring the costs down and we try to bring the gains up. And the best way to do this in industrial agriculture is to reduce the cost of labor. And what the food forest does, it actually increases the cost of labor by a lot. So it would be less economically interesting, but it also increases the joy that people get from the business, right? So it is much easier to get volunteers to wander through a food forest in search of interesting products to put in their Michelin star restaurant than it is to get them to go to an apple orchard and pick apples. So if we treat cost of labor in a different way and we say that the labor is paid with joy, not with money, then a food forest is economically much, much, much more interesting. But traditional industrial farmers, they see a food forest as a somewhat naive, stupid system that will never make them money. So it is, that's why I call it regenerative entrepreneurship. You need to think about moving from an extractive cost and profit driven system to a circular happiness driven system, so to speak. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there is. So if you look at the problem of food production from a more traditional, classical, industrial way, so that is not the old-fashioned way where people were much more spiritual about food. You can measure the contents of the food, and there's been lots of research that biologically, organically grown crops contain more nutrients, more minerals, more vitamins than the ones produced in monocultures on high-input agriculture. So there is a chemical, biochemical advantage of doing it this way. But I think there is a much bigger advantage in terms of, you harvest not only chemicals from a system, you harvest also emotions and a spiritual positive effect. So I think that effect of the food forest is very poorly understood by humans, modern humans. But you see that, for example, the Amazon is also a food forest, and there is lots of science that has been manipulated by humans for a very long time, and those native humans in the Amazon, they think about the food production in a very different way than we do. They pray to the trees, basically. And so I think that aspect that is not a chemical or physical aspect of the food forest is very important and very poorly understood. Mm-hmm. And I'm much happier in a food forest than I am in an orchard, and I've tried both. And I don't think it has much to do with the nutrition value. Yeah, so in terms of economic benefit to the food forest farmer, I think that we are still at the very beginning of figuring out how to do this. So we are the pioneers. We have the privilege of being able to play around and make mistakes and fall on our faces. But there is some very promising signs that with a food forest system, you can make much more money per acre of land than with a traditional farming business. Because to give you an example, if you would do potatoes on a hectare of land, you will harvest 46 tons of potatoes and barely break even. That's a lot of food and very little money to pay your workers with or yourself. And for example, a 2-hectare food forest in the Netherlands sells directly to a 2-Michelin star restaurant. So if you have the Michelin star restaurant paying for the premium product because they have the brand of being able to sell very, very special dishes that can only be produced in a food forest, you can imagine that 1 kilo of produce is several orders of magnitude more valuable than the produce that comes from a potato farm.
Okay.
So I think that is an important... When you look at this video footage, you will probably see butterflies and other insects flying in the background. And it means that this system, even though it's very populated, is reasonably biodiverse. This garden, by accident, looks a little bit like a food forest, and that helps the insects come to it. So you already see an effect of a very small food forest-like setup that is very far from a perfect food forest on biodiversity. If you imagine in the Netherlands, where I'm from, biodiversity should be much, much higher than in Hungary, because it's a very interesting, diverse swampland, right? And if you look at the current biodiversity crisis in the Netherlands, we have 60% of all of our species on 2% of our area, which is the dunes. And we think that food forests currently in that very broken system have a more positive impact on biodiversity than natural reserves. We see also that, for example, the more mature food forests of about 10 years old, they are more biodiverse than the nature reserves next door. So we believe that with going for about 25% of food forests in our agricultural landscape, we can almost completely undo the harm that humanity has done to the natural ecosystem in our country. And that would be extremely impressive if we pull that off. CO2 exhaust or greenhouse gas exhaust by humanity is not even stabilizing. And one of the main causes of this is agriculture. More than half of the land that is available to us is used for agriculture, and more than 99% of it is CO2 positive, so producing more CO2 than it's capturing carbon. And this is completely ridiculous conceptually, biochemically, physically, because the most effective way of storing carbon is inside natural ecosystems through photosynthesis. So one of the things I've been doing next to my food forest business is to see how we can work with carbon certificates produced by natural means to have food production and carbon capture go together instead of fighting with it. Most of that carbon is not stored inside the trees or inside the plants, but it's stored beneath the soil, in the fungi and the other soil creatures that live with carbon. And modern agriculture essentially works by breaking the cycle of carbon storage. And what we do, the most extreme example is that we burn a forest, put grassland on it, and feed it to cows. That is the absolutely most insane thing you can do to produce food for humans, because the forest produces more food than the meat of the cows, but also the complete natural storage of carbon that was in that forest will be emitted into the air before you even start. So that is why it's very important to close this carbon cycle and to make the agriculture store carbon again. Many people come to us and ask for help to start their food forest, and they have all kinds of different starting situations. So sometimes the land is completely barren, it used to be industrial or industrial agriculture. Sometimes they start with an orchard, sometimes they start with a forest. And you must imagine in the Netherlands we have forests that were completely focused on wood production for the mines, so it's not a natural system by any means. And from all these different systems they want to start, and they need the help of a designer like me to get them on the right path. And usually the first thing I tell them is that you don't need to worry, because the natural system already knows what to do. Every system will turn into a food forest if you do nothing. But if you want to eat well and you have preferences on what to eat, you may want to steer it in a certain direction. But the big answer to start a food forest, what do you need to do first? The first thing to do is nothing. It's beautiful, huh? Yeah, so if you have a traditional orchard and you want to turn this traditional orchard into a food forest, we're actually in a similar kind of situation right now. What would happen is, if you let nature do its thing, it would introduce the missing layers automatically. So in the background you can see the brambles climbing up to the hazels and the elderberries, and it turns itself into a mess to maximize photosynthesis. Brambles are not necessarily the most enjoyable plant to have in your garden, because if it's completely covered in brambles you will make lots of animals very happy, but not Homo sapiens. So what you want to do in that orchard is introduce competitors of brambles that are more enjoyable for humans. So there are many kinds of berries that also climb and have less horrific stinging parts, and basically less defense against humans. So you introduce what you like that competes with the natural equivalent, and then the system will turn into a human-designed food forest instead of a natural food forest. And so many people think about what they need to add to improve things. And what's very important to understand is that the idea that nature is not good enough for us is a strange idea. And nature knows exactly what to do. So nature has a way of taking nitrogen out of the air and turning it into fertilizer. It's called nitrogen fixing. There are plants that collaborate with bacteria for millions of years that do this very efficiently. And these plants are also what is fed to cows to produce manure. So if you have those plants in your food forest, and there is also other animals in your food forest, like insects, eating those plants, the whole system will fertilize itself. If you have pests, you need to get rid of the pests, but you should imagine that those pests are also food for the pest control systems that nature has for them, which are called, I don't know the English name of these wasps, but there is like millions of species that do pest control, and they feel very unhappy on a monoculture system. But if you improve the monoculture system to make those animals happy in that system, pest control will take care of itself. One of the downsides that I think is valid to a food forest, and I haven't got a really good response to that, is that people like views. We are naturally creatures of the big plains. We like to run on a big plain and know where we are and look around. And a food forest, to some people, actually feels threatening because it's so dense. I am more of a forest creature, I feel, and I feel very comfortable in such a system, but I think it is right to consider that some people would miss the view. If you look here in the background, you will not see the horizon with water on it of the Balaton Lake. And if we would create a food forest everywhere, we would not be able to see the horizons anymore. That is one of the downsides I think is valid to consider.